All to the release of Arun Ferreira's Colors of the Cage. Arun, with his brother Sanjeev, to see me a little after he had been released and decided that he wanted to do a small collection of his drawings. And I, of course, decided to bully him relentlessly, and I told him that his experience was much richer and that he should try to write a book. And Arun thought that he wanted to see this in 2 months, and it's been about 2 years. So, but congratulations, and you must be very proud of your work. Arun, of course, you all know him. He studied at St. Xavier's College, and he's been a long-time activist. He was an activist from the time he was at St. Xavier's College, among other things, organizing the canteen workers. After he graduated, he's been involved with a great many causes. Among other things, he spent time as a community organizer in Vidarbh. He is also a cartoonist and did a series of really powerful drawings, especially when he was in jail. But he's also done over the years drawings about social and political issues that have appeared in several publications, including in students' publications and workers' magazines. He's now pursuing a degree in law and researching the history of democratic rights movement in Bombay. Mr. Vini Rao is sort of such an enormous personality, it's quite difficult to contain his bio in a couple of sentences. He started writing poetry and criticism from the time he was in college. He was a lecturer by profession and taught Telugu literature for almost 40 years. He's one of the founder members of the Viplava Rachitalai Sangam. Have I got that right? Which means the Revolutionary Writers Association. And also of the All India League for Revolutionary Culture. He's done 7 anthologies of poems, and his thesis in Telugu is about the Telugu liberation struggle. The Telugu novel, a study of interrelationships of society and literature, which he did in 1983. He's also translated into Telugu Gugi One, how do you pronounce the last name? Thiango's novel, Devil on the Cross, and a writer's prison diary detained during the time he was in jail in 1985, from 1985 to 1989. His own letter from jail was published by Penguin in 2010. He has a long association of being a guest of the Indian government, and will be able to tell us what it's like to be in jail. Ramo Ramanathan, my old friend, is a playwright and director. One of his more recent productions is Comrade Kumbhakarna, which was inspired, among other things, by Arun and other friends here being confined in jail. He's written a great many plays, among sort of the most, my favorite of his plays is one called Jazz, simply because he and I collaborated on that. But another play of his that's really touched me is Cotton 54, Polyester 86, about the struggles of the textile workers in Bombay. Before we start, may I invite Mr. Rao and Ramo to release the book. Thank you. To begin with, may I invite Arun to read a couple of passages from the book?
Arun? Actually, today is 26th, and exactly probably 3 years ago, 26th of September, was the day I was waiting for the next day to be released. Around the same time, the barracks were shut and we were waiting the next day I'm going to be released. So I thought it would be best to read that section because to an extent it talks about how the emotions I went to, what happened the day I got rearrested. And after the rearrest also in this very same press club, there was a meeting and people started talking about my case. So I thought it would be best to read about that and those events. It's from chapter 6, The Lal Gate. On the morning of 27 September 2011, I received a mulaqat from my lawyers, mother and brother. We excitedly discussed all that we would do after my release. I had informed them that it would take a couple of hours to complete the procedures for securing my release before being able to meet them. By 2 p.m., all those to be released were lined up before the Lal Gate. I was deliberately kept at the very last. As I stepped through the wicket door, a group of men pounced on me. I could not see my mother or lawyer. Who spoke. I later came to know had been made to stand beyond the outer wall of the prison. I attempted to scream and alert them, but the men had their hands clapped on my mouth. And pushing down my head, they dragged me out of the gate. Within seconds, they dumped me into an unnumbered white Tata Sumo that had been parked a few feet from the gate. 6 men jumped into the vehicle and I was driven out of the prison premises. My mother, brother and advocates who had come to receive me were pushed out of the prison by the authorities. My lawyers immediately went to the local police station. But the cops there refused to register a complaint regarding my abduction. It was obvious that personnel from the police station and the prison authorities had assisted my abductors. I was taken out of the city. My abductors, who I assumed were policemen, were armed and refused to disclose their identities, the purpose of my abduction, or our destination. I pleaded with them to ease my family's anxieties by informing them or my advocates about my whereabouts. They refused despite having modern mobile phones on, which they were receiving repeated instructions from their seniors. After about 3 hours, I was taken to the police station in Gachhuli district. It goes on and the section ends with actually the emotions which I went through. I was crushed at the thought of having to run through the same cycle of torture, bailout applications, and waiting endlessly for trial dates. With that, I wish to come.
So, Arun, among the things that really jumps out of your book is the human emotions that run through your experiences. So I'm going to bully you again and ask you to read that wonderful passage about food and hunger
Thank you. passage that you've read the book closely.
This is Naresh's favorite book, probably. So he asked me. This is on page 79, about Christmas. Actually, it's a letter I'd written to my house talking about Christmas. Christmas was a time when, at least when we were under barrack or barracks, which we couldn't go out, it was a time that some NGOs would have a mass. So we would get the opportunity to go out of our barracks and interact with other prisoners. The small piece which I have written in that regard. At the end of every year, the prisoners are counted. Oh, sorry, I'll go ahead. By now, I had spent 18 months in prison and was much better aware of its rhythms. Practices that would seem bizarre in the outside world became routine behind the walls. For instance, the trapping and hunting of squirrels, birds, bandicoots, another type of small game, was a serious occupation because the Maharashtra government had imposed a near total ban on non-vegetarian food in prison. Even locusts and other insects that occasionally swarmed the prison were collected to be sun-dried, roasted and relished. Claw traps sometimes managed to snare a bird. Others were brought down with makeshift catapults. Traps in drain pipes and other passages could be made to yield bandicoots. But a more popular method for both squirrels and rats was hunting by hand and stick. If one was sighted, the cry went up and hunters gathered to corner their prey. A well-fed bandicoot, which tastes a lot like pork, was a sizable feast for a meat-starved group. It was quickly skinned and cooked in a corner away from the prying eyes of jail staff and the informants. The spot behind the latrines was considered safe. This was done on the watch of the latrine cleaning dandakaman, who are usually low caste or tribals. They were omnivorous and enthusiastic participants in both the chase and the feast. As the band sat down for the treat, the conversation would drift back to better times. One person would talk of wild boars, another remember rabbits. The high walls and iron bars would fade away. Things weren't as bad as they seemed.
Arun, throughout your book you talk about the treatment you received in police custody, both within jail and out of jail. To ask you a big cosmic question, what are the fundamental problems with our criminal justice system?
Actually, on the prison system or the criminal justice system, as we talk about, many people have written about it. Like, for example, overcrowding is a word which is quite often. You'll see many organizations talking about overcrowding, or bail is not granted, or hygiene conditions, or probably the violations of human rights and all. I think so, if I would have to talk about two or three fundamental problems where this, which out pockets the root of all these things, I think so. One is how we as a society see prisoners. I think so that has to be drastically changed to an extent. I'm not talking about the human rights violations in jails and all that. But the question is, we generally see prisoners as something that, you know, we can, if they are not needed in society, we can click them away in the trash can and, you know, forget about them. So the Supreme Court or various courts have spoken about how prisoners also have their human rights. Prisoners have their rights. These are rights have to be respected. This is not something now new. But from the past 30 years, 40 years, in 1980s, the Supreme Court have passed judgments like that. but somehow we have not been able to implement them. The government is not keen to implement them. As a society, we are not demanding from the government to implement them. So we are very happy to extend if a prisoner, someone who is given a death sentence, is kept in jail till he dies. We think in those terms. I think so. That is a problem that we really have to think about. It's not only vis-a-vis the state, but as a society, we have to think about how questioning such things. Prisoners have their own rights. Prisoners have death sentence prisoners or prisoners who have committed the worst crimes also. We have to think about how to rehabilitate them back in society. Another thing which I thought would be important for Indian prisons is that, to an extent, Indian prisons, there's this high walls which are blocked out anything that happens inside. Because what I have written in jail is that sometimes it's so absurd, because practices which are there, from British times are continuing till now. I was just talking to someone the other day, is that in prison, in the Maharashtra prisons till now, it's so ridiculous that the entire cycle of a prison life starts from sunrise to sunset. Now, during British times, when there were no phones, there were no clocks probably, that would make sense. But now it doesn't make sense to have an entire cycle of jail life starting from sunrise to sunset. So we used to get our dinner at 4 o'clock in the evening. These are things that have to be, and no one talks about it. Why? Because no one knows what's going on in prison. So something like transparency, where for example, if there is a human rights violation at a police station, the press is interested, people are interested, okay, we can talk about it. But what is happening in prison, sometimes no one can see it, and it just becomes something frozen in time, which I try to bring out in my book.
There's some irony to your experience in prison, in that when you were there, you decided to do a course in human rights from the Open University. How did that change your perception of your situation? How did your experience influence the way in which you were approaching your assignments and things?
Before doing a course in human rights, I've been talking about human rights even earlier on. So in a sense, it did not change my perspective in a big way. But a big difference which happens is that you realize that ultimately, what we talk about human rights now, or what we so fundamentally call constitutional rights, or something that we should regard, these have been born in times of struggle and revolution. The Magna Carta, or the French Revolution, or the Declaration. And somehow we tend, when we talk about human rights, we tend to dissociate the struggle aspect to it. What I saw in prison is that talking about human rights doesn't make sense just talking. It has to be joined up with struggle for its implementation. In fact, in the book I mentioned about it, the entire process of getting the human rights courses, books in jail, was a struggle. The jailer kept telling me when he saw on the books, the course books, that diploma course in human rights, he was really scared that this guy is going to do something, he's going to inside prison violence or something like that. So this is just a statement about human rights doesn't make sense. We have to link it up with struggle. I think so. That is what brought me to a stronger realization in prison and doing a course in that sense.
You were even access to a copy of the Constitution.
Yeah.
Because they thought it was so big you could literally use it as a weapon.
Yeah. I remember actually some of my friends who were in jail, but I remember that incident where I got a constitution. Some of the lawyers, one of my lawyers was here, Maruk, she had sent it with my family, and they passed it to the jail gate. And when I got it in the jail, the deputy superintendent said he won't give it to me. Why? It was too bulky. So we had to fight with him that this is the constitution. Ultimately, he said, no, it's too bulky, we can't give it to you. Ultimately, we said, okay. We dug out some old disrespect to the national flag and all. And in the round of the superintendent, we treated him that, you're giving me the constitution, or should we file a complaint to a local police station? Invariably, the next day, we got the constitution.
Mr. Arun spent a lot of time in solitary confinement, and that's something you know a little about. You were famously in solitary for 1,001 days and nights. Can you tell us about your experience in solitary?
Of course, in some respects, this physical torture which Arun and many prisoners in Maharashtra have undergone, particularly political prisoners in Maharashtra have undergone, that physical torture aspect was not there for me. Why, I don't know, but maybe because I'm a known writer and a college teacher, and all the time working outside as a mass activist. From 1973 onwards, though I was being arrested time and again the last 40 years, except once or twice, depending on, suppose I'm implicated in a conspiracy case, treatment used to be very cruel. Cruel in the sense more in the abuses, threats, and humiliating me, making me stand up and all that. But when I am detained under MISA during emergency, and interestingly during the emergency, it was also interesting because a section of the ruling class was against the emergency. So particularly the police officer who arrested me in Warangal was related to Sanjeev Reddy, that he was against the emergency. So he respected me. He was saying that now you are on par with Jayaprakash Narayan and others. So he gave me chair and all that and sent to jail very respectfully. Particularly when this Ramnagar conspiracy case, in fact, I was not arrested in the Ramnagar conspiracy case for that matter. I was there in jail earlier in the Sikandarabad conspiracy case. In fact, in a way, I was transferred from Sikandarabad conspiracy case into Ramnagar conspiracy case. Sikandarabad conspiracy case ran from 1974 to 1989. In between came the Ramnagar conspiracy case in 1986. By then I was in jail in the Sikandarabad conspiracy case. So when Nalla Adi Reddy alias Shyam, who was the secretary of the state party, was arrested along with his six associates, when this Ramnagar conspiracy case was made, though I was in jail, I was implicated in it and was continued in the jail. When I was shifted into this Ramnagar conspiracy case, it was a case under Tada. It was a conspiracy case and under Tada. So I was shifted into isolation. Till then I was like Arun, I was in Fasigat. I was in Fasigat in Mushirabad jail. Because there was no accommodation in the jail for political prisoners. All the time they have taken care that the political prisoners don't meet others. That's where people outside cannot understand that. They think that political prisoners are asking for privilege. It's not that political prisoners are asking for privilege. In fact, the political prisoners wanted them to meet the other prisoners. But the state will not allow this. Right from the time of Paradipuram conspiracy case, you can see, when those people, when 180 people, 8 people were implicated in Paradipuram conspiracy case in 1969, those who were arrested were brought into quarantine in Visakhapatnam jail. In Visakhapatnam jail, quarantine is meant for, during the British days, it was meant for those who come in the via sea. That is, the people who are arrested on the sea, that is sea thieves, they were brought to Visakhapatnam jail and put in quarantine so that they will have the sea diseases. And political prisoners are put in the quarantine jail in isolation. So putting the political prisoners in isolation, like the putting the people in Anda cell in Nagpur, or today GN Sai Baba being put in Anda cell, this is all the time they will try to isolate the political prisoners from the common there, so that they will influence the common people. It's true also. Because outside also we do the same thing, in jails also we do the same thing. So, since we will influence the other prisoners, because our concept, as Charavandras has written, that this Indian state itself is a big jail and a small jail in this jail. So, the very concept of the Brahminical concept of crime and punishment, as you are asking Arun, the very concept of crime and punishment, and particularly our mind also, particularly the middle class mind also, as long as you are outside, they may not treat you as a criminal. Once you are sent to jail, particularly being an undertime prisoner or a convict, Well, Tanvir said that they made some crime. Particularly, Arun describes in his book about a rape victim. Naturally, the society will not have any sympathy for a rape, one who indulges in rape. One accuser who comes in a rape case, made to crawl from the jail gate to his cell or whatever place, and he says that, of course, we may not have sympathy, but the one who makes him to crawl from jail gate to other, he was also a rape victim once, but he has become a dada in jail. So he has become a dada in jail, that's why he gets that moral authority to make this rape accuser to crawl from there. This is our concept. So, because of this concept, I was put in 1,000 nights as because I was reading Marcuse in the Jail, 100 Years of Solitude. During that time, I have read Latin American literature and African literature also during that time. And there, because it was a big enclosure. Besides my enclosure, was another enclosure where Shyam and others are kept. I was put in a very, very big enclosure. In that big enclosure, I was put alone. I was put alone for 1,000 days and nights. And only my friends were the jail jawan who keeps a watch outside, and a newspaper boy who comes and goes, or one who supplies me food. Only, and the treatment is early in the morning, or maybe after 9 or 10:30, all the newspapers come to me. All the books come to me, but only I don't see people. I see trees, I see birds, I see sky in the daytime, night that also is not there. Night times when I am locked at 6 o'clock, in that cage, I used to walk, and I have written in one of my letters also that pair of now they sitting in the window. While I was walking, their privacy may not be disturbed. I was walking very slowly. Interestingly, when chartered accountant from Bombay who read that article, he said that you kept him as a terrorist in jail, making him very violent person. When I read his article that he did not disturb even the pair of the birds, how can you say that he is violent? And he wrote a letter to the Chief Justice of India, President of India, and the Prime Minister of India, that to him I must be released from chartered accountant from Bombay, I have forgotten his name now, in 1988. So that was my solitary confinement, only books, newspapers, birds, which I have written as my, in Telugu I called, the name in English is Captive Imagination, but in Telugu it is Sahacharulu, my friends. 13 people are my friends, like 13 people are friends of Jesus Christ. 13 people are my friends, birds, trees, books, newspapers, letters I get. About the letter censorship also Arun has written in his book. So there are many similarities for the in the context of mental agony one undergoes. I think this is same to it. That's why I also wrote, why this 14 years? 7 years is 14 years. Why 7 years, 14 years? Because those in jail, they don't have any difference between day and night. They don't sleep in the night. So a day becomes 2 days for them. So a lifer is released after 7 years means it is 14 years for them. 14 years with remission will come to 20 years. That's how the prisoners calculate. So for a going under a mental agony, or the feelings, this is one and same for everybody.
So do you read a passage perhaps from your book?
Not a passage, but I will read a poem from the book. Of course, waiting is a very burdensome thing for the prisoner. What will you write of in captivity? Freedom. What will you think of in solitude? The world, But when you speak of under a ban, the truth, what do you seek in exile? The solution. What when you bring to mind in forgetfulness? History. What do you think about in silence? Humanity. What do you dream of a day and night? The future. If the answer is implicit in the question and if possible through a pun or turn of phrase to material reality, then imagination is man's life here. It is a curse. And a colorful rainbow too, as he puts that color gauge. And a colorful rainbow too is an extraordinary material reality. In fact, you know, in jail, imagination is curse and also a boom, both. One of the poems I titled the name Pagaru Renditiki. That means the so-called, all of us are treated as Naxalite prisoners, or for that matter after Tada, all of us are treated as terrorist prisoners. So for this terrorist, the interviews are used to be given at 2 o'clock in the afternoon on the base jails. So I was waiting for my wife and children to come. Only my wife and children were allowed, none else were allowed during this Ramnagar conspiracy case. And when my wife comes, there used to be 4 intelligence people. Local police, state police, central intelligence, and another intelligence, 4 people. In between us they used to sit. And around us they used to sit. And half an hour interview. That starts at 2 o'clock. For this we will be waiting for the whole week we will be waiting for this half an hour meeting. Which starts at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. In Telugu it is called Pagalu. Afternoon means Pagalu. 2 o'clock is Rendintiki. It's a pun there. Pagalu is enmity. Rendintiki, 2 classes. The state and myself. State on the other side and myself this side. And there is enmity between the state and the people. With that pun, I wrote a poem also.
Ramu, you were inspired by Arun's experience and experience of his friends to create a play. What was it about this specific incident that moved you so much?
Now?
Yeah.
So 2 or 3 things. One is, in the last 7 to 8 years, we've been seeing all kinds of disorder, especially in Maharashtra. And the few friends, colleagues, comrades that I was associated with were with sort of increasing alacrity, either being arrested or on the radar. And there were instances of, charge sheets, some of them were being imprisoned and so on. And then, of course, subsequently, 2 things happened. One was the process of visiting some of them in court, especially the sessions courts and the smaller courts. And 2 things there. One is that it's a labyrinthine process, and secondly, it's a very long-run process. It just tires you, and it sort of kills hope in you. And you see that, this sort of diminishing of civil society, the democratic space, etc. And the second thing was some of the, writings that I had access to, again, through a few friends who are in the audience right now. What emerged out of this whole thing was that, normally one writes petitions, attends rallies, meetings and so on. And it's normally the same people. And in Mumbai and Pune and Maharashtra, I think we all knew what was happening. The question was how to get it outside. So there's a friend of mine called Mohit Kakalkar from Pune who was working in Delhi at the NSD, which is an irony because it's a state-sponsored, theater body. So this play called Comrade Kumbhakarna, which is based on a Hindu mythology of Kumbhakarna being a Rakshasa. And we sort of subverted that particular motif and used that. And the idea was essentially to perform the play and shows outside of Maharashtra. So fortunately, this play was produced by NSD. And it was one of the sort of nice ironies of life that NSD did not realize what the play is about. But it was a play about political prisoners and what actually is transpiring in particularly in Tamil Nadu. And so it was, a lot of it was material that we'd used from Varnon, some of it from Arun, etc. So it was metafiction. As you know, I'm not capable of writing fictional plays. I usually borrow from whatever is available. So that was kind of nice. The interesting thing is that fortunately what we are finding in the last
a few years is that Comrade Kumbhakarna is a good example because it traveled in Uttar Pradesh, Haryana, and it was important because it gave people an access to what was happening here. And then there was an essay which I was able to write thanks to the help of Susan, and so that got circulated, which is a more sort of serious essay. But in addition to that, there have been three or four other things that have been happening. I think what Sambhaji's play, Shivaji Underground, that has traveled in Mumbai, in Maharashtra, it has traveled outside of the city, out of the state. I think that is important. What Sushma Deshpande and Urmila Pawar are doing with Ayadan, I think that's important. Chaitanya Tamani's film called Court. So certainly in the last 4 or 5 years, we are finding works of fiction by very important people in Maharashtra who are endeavoring to take this fight outside of the state and make sure that these stories are heard. I think that is encouraging, very, very encouraging.
Making a bit of a leap on. Arun, you speak about the UAPA quite a lot and you even call it unconstitutional. Will you tell us a little about your position on that law?
Actually, through my experience in jail, about unlawful activities prevention act, because the state, the time it was passed was in 2004, when the state said that it's going to repeal quota and bring in unlawful activities prevention act, and the Congress government at the time, you know, made this entire image and this entire propaganda saying that quota is bad, TADA is bad, we are coming up with a better law. But actually, we have been fooled. We have been horribly fooled in the entire process, because what was then TADA, what was then quota, in fact, down the years it has come with vengeance. So when quota goes, the very same day, Unlawful Activities Prevention Act is brought in, and chapters from quota are just cut-pasted into Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. Quota, which bans organizations for the first time in India, which after many years, Unlawful Activities Prevention Act also bans organizations in this. So lots of the things which TADA and quota did earlier along, Unlawful Activities Prevention Act still does. And the biggest tragedy is now that TADA and quota had a sunset clause. That means after some time they could relapse and we could, you know, think about reviewing them and extending it. But Unlawful Activities Prevention Act does not have a sunset clause. So this is an act which is here to stay. No government is going to review it. It's just going to be an act for quite some time. And they have pegged it on the UN resolution after the 9/11 war against terror. So all around the world, the government wants to, you know, ban terrorist organizations. So this Unlawful Activities Prevention Act is also put into place to ban so-called terrorist organizations. See, two things which I think, apart from the details of the acts, I think so, two things which I find cruel in this act, which is that is, one is it, the guilt of your ideology is where, and ideology is banned, the freedom of thought and expression, or freedom mean to hold the ideology, that is something which the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act expresses. And I have seen throughout my years in jail, even now, when people who get arrested, if this book is just read, it can be picked up and, you know, the cops can say it's Maoist. I have written in the book how when the cops came to my house, they picked up CDs which ultimately landed up to be the nursery rhymes of my son, or sociology books of my wife. It means these are the basis on which you make someone the Maoist. The second thing is guilt by association. I think so if I know someone who is a Maoist, or I know someone who, you know, is a criminal, is a so-called criminal, I can be arrested, I can be kept for so many years in jail. So someone like Sai Baba, whose case is coming up, is that his crime is what? Is that he's supposed to have sent a letter by courier or whatever to the secretary of the Maoist party. Now, people are saying the letter is there, not there, I'm not going into that, but I'm actually challenging the very logic of it, is that if a political person wants to send a letter to a political party, whether it is banned, what is the crime? It is as simple as if a chai wala wants to sell chai to a criminal, is it something wrong? If a political person wants to send a letter, so these are some things which I think they actually shape the fundamentals of what we call democratic rights and all that. So I think that's why I find Unlawful Activities Prevention Act very dangerous.
Arun, in his book, talks about how these acts have got, these laws have got so much more restrictive, especially after 9/11. But you, of course, have experience of these from much before, even in the 70s, MISA and all these other. How have they changed over the time that you have been booked under some of these provisions?
It's true that it's coming after 9/11. Of course, it's coming after 9/11 more seriously about minorities, particularly Muslims. But for Maoists or those who are supporting the Naxalbari movement, it is there from 1969 onwards. Day by day, since Maoists are branded as, they were used to be branded as extremists, then they are now branding them as terrorists also. So since the branding them is being changed, but and they are also treated along with the Islamist the fundamentalists and on par with them, that's why also the it's more serious. Let me first add something about the UAPA first. You see, again, all these things come about the middle class mindset in the country. When it is a preventive detention act, we react more seriously, or we talk about it. When it is an act outside the penal code, like TADA and POTA also, we talk about it. But the criminal procedure code itself is amended in 1967 amendment. When UAPA has come, the response is less. That means we accept the Indian Penal Code, we accept the Criminal Procedure Code, which means the general, the system outside accept this as a given code. There is an acceptability for that. Outside these things, when the laws are made, we are protesting. But when the laws are made within this criminal procedure, that's why you have many acts in Maharashtra, Chhattisgarh, Andhra, everywhere such acts are coming. But the protest which was there for POTA and TADA, that kind of protest is not there against UAPA, because this UAPA has become a part of the criminal procedure code today. That is the problem. That means we have to question the criminal procedure code itself now, and of course, in some aspects, particularly about the 124A, sedition. Now there is a protest about that. But nobody here has protested about the waging war on the state. Interestingly, in the Secunderabad conspiracy case, when we were acquitted, the judge observed that they are not waging war on the state. He made an observation about that. But the state assumes, and also the system outside assumes, that you cannot wage war against the state here. So this concept, in fact, the waging war against state, sedition, criminal conspiracy in the context of political dissent, all these things have come to stay from Naxalbari onwards. And because Naxalbari is not only about, it talks about a new democratic revolution, it also talks about the seizure of state. So since it speaks about the seizure of state and a seizure of state power, naturally the laws which are there in the Indian Penal Code given by the British people are accepted by the system now. So from that day onwards, this onslaught and the particularly Maoist activists or the Naxalite activists, whatever name you call, it is there. Added to this, after emergency, you know, during the emergency the fundamental rights also were denied. After emergency, one by one the minorities are being attacked. And minorities are being seen as suspicious films, not only in this country, outside also. This was a treatment for Sikhs for a longer period, and this is a treatment for Muslim minorities till now. And 9/11, for that man, 9/11 has got a different context also. The Chilean coup also has taken place on 9/11. But people don't talk about that. People talk about only the World Trade Organization's attack. when the Delhi elected government was dethroned by a copper industry coup and Alendi was killed in his presidential residence. That also happened on line level. But people don't talk about that. So the problem with the system is it accepts the given ideology of the rulers. That is the problem. So that's why all these laws are coming. And I was surprised also because though there are so many encounter killings, state violence and all that in Andhra Pradesh and Telangana areas, and torture before you are submitted to the judicial custody, it's there everywhere. But torture after giving to judicial custody also, it is something new for me, which I have read in Arun's book. Even for very so-called, within courts, the dreaded Naxalite also, it did not happen in Andhra Pradesh. Once you are given to judicial custody, say for 15 days, they may keep you for 15 days in their custody. You have a right not to answer for any question, which the political prisoners generally exercise, very scrupulously they exercise. They keep silent. They will not answer. And they get bored and release you, submit you to the court before 15 days itself. It happened to, for example, it happened to Venugopal. He was taken to police custody from the court for 3 days. In the first instance, he told that I will not answer your questions even if you keep me for 3 days. So next day they have brought him and submitted to court, surrendered, gave to judicial custody. Whereas in Arun's case, even in the judicial custody, for 15 days, he went to all kinds of very heinous tortures. This, I think, on such matters, I'm sorry to say that Maharashtra intelligentsia is not responding to these things. I'm sorry to say. This will not happen. And about UAPA also, yes, it's a very dreaded law. We had, particularly the Muslim minorities had that experience in Kerala, very bitter experience in Kerala. In other places also. But in Andhra Pradesh, a civil liberties activist, an Adivasi activist, who was arrested at the UAPA, was given bail within a week in a district court. We are implicated in UAPA cases, more than 2-3 cases there are UAPA cases on me. I am not arrested. This is a reflection on the democratic movement. And I think Arun's book must make the people here sitting, particularly this is press club, the media and the democracy here, they have to react on these issues. Using of this, and because they react, because people like Bhagat Singh made the whole penal code and sedition acts, they just foo-fooed the law. They have refused to recognize that law. But today when all these laws are coming upon us and we are accepting it, these draconian laws we are accepting as they are, as if they are very sacred laws. Because the Rajiv Gandhi has come to power with 401 seats, suppose any law is made in parliament, can it be a sacred law? So I think the middle class intellectuals have to learn the defied law. Because the law is nothing but the law given by the colonial system.
This is a good stage at which to talk about one of the campaigns Ramo has been involved in, which is the campaign around the Kabir Kalamat. Can you tell us something about that situation? And a section of opinion in Maharashtra, the intelligentsia that Mr. speaks about, has been mobilized against the state in this case.
So I think 2-3 things have happened. One is, consciously the movement from which Kabir Kalamanch and a whole lot of other groups are particularly seen as Ambedkarites. And in that sense, there is a tag on that. And so, the superstructure that exists and automatically they are outside of that superstructure. So even something like, and it's interesting because say Mumbai today has about 1500 shows. We have about 30 odd auditoriums in which plays happen constantly. And when there is a play like Shivaji Underground in Bhimnagar, which later on, of course, did 300, 400 shows, initially it is denied permission because it has the tag of Jai Bhim. So automatically you notice that the trusteeship is controlled, the allocation of dates. So you have there's a veneer of sort of democracy where you have 1500 shows apparently happening in four languages, multiple across the city per month. But suddenly when there's a play with the tag, so then again this particular group has to use a particular kind of strategy, and therefore there is a producer put in, and there's Nandu Mahadev who comes in, and therefore they slip in. And then the difficulty in performing in places like, whether it is Shivaji Mandir and so on. So that difficulty, this is a group which has a bit of money power, they have a bit of clout in the media, and they're able to sort of escalate that But the larger problem I think that exists is I think twofold. One is, just like in today the sort of sexuality of women is constantly being denied, there is a certain class system that exists, or a caste system that essentially denies equal rights for all castes in Maharashtra. I think that is one of the bigger issues, and it's very evident from what is happening outside. So that is, I think, one aspect of it. The second thing is, again, when we were there in Pune for Narendra Dabulkar's first anniversary, and after a year we still don't have an idea, and it's obviously the state is complicit in this whole thing. There cannot be a political assassination of that kind happening, and hundreds of them happening without the complicity of the state. So when that sort of a thing happens, and you wonder, and then you listen to what Dabulkar himself has to say, that caste itself is the biggest superstition in Hinduism. If you're able not to take that out, then so these are sort of enormous amounts of concern. The third thing that really bothers is that because of this whole superstructure, there is a denial that the works of art, an entire cultural movement, an entire habit, denotative grammar, everything else has been given a secondary place in the structure of art itself. So that which has been created by the Brahmins automatically, or the upper caste, become art. That which is created by the Ambedkarites necessarily become overtly political and therefore bad art. So one way to fight the whole thing is write great poetry like Sir over here, or what Sudhir and everybody else have been trying to do with the Vidrohi movement. But at the same time, so the combat is constantly on, and the point is at some point they have to start listening. And I think gradually, some of the examples that I gave you earlier, I think that process has begun, but it has to be mobilized at a far greater extent. It has to get outside of Maharashtra, it has to get within the intelligentsia, and there's been a certain abandonment of this project. If that comes back, I think trade unionists, thinkers, academics, they will need to return to this.
Thanks. At this stage, I think we'll throw it open to the audience for questions. Can I request you to please ask questions and not make speeches? And I will be very rude if somebody goes above a minute before they get to their question. Please put your hand up, and can I have a volunteer please to take the mic around? Well, there are no questions. So I don't... Oh, can you please identify yourself?
Chitrangada, I'm a journalist and researcher based in Orissa. So I was conducting some research in a library this week, and I happened to come across old media reports from when you were arrested and your friends were arrested. So the immediate thing that strikes one is, how problematic the media coverage is, and this is something I think you've raised also. So the other issue of prisoners' rights is obviously that you don't have access to the media. When I tried to meet Binayak Sen after he was arrested, the jailer allowed me to meet him but said you can't quote anything that he says. So given this climate, how can we have better coverage of these issues? What are some of the things that you think even the media needs to start raising?
That is true, that in fact, trial by media, in fact, when someone is arrested, the first thing that comes into papers is these accusations, barrage of accusations on this side of the state. Things so that happens, and the question about meeting, means the voice of the accused doesn't come across. I think so. You have spoken basically on the points that you wanted to want me to say. I think so. The dangerous part, which I see bigger in these past few years, is that where the state is using the media as a tool. I think so. I don't know, but I have just noticed it much more. Is that for example, I'll give you the case of the Kabir Kalamanch people, the Pune case, which I have been following up quite a bit. You know, there is a charge sheet which the prosecution gets a copy and the accused gets a copy. So if statements from the charge sheet goes to the press and they get printed in the next day's papers, and if the accused has not given it, it doesn't make, you don't need to know who has given it. So systematically, sometimes the media is fed information. I don't know, probably people in the media will know this much better than me. Systematically, people in the media are trained to put in the voice of the state. I think so. That is where the greater danger lies. And I don't know whether this is a better, this is a good forum to talk about. I think so. This is a part of a all-round probably a repression on democratic rights, because that is an arena earlier which we could fight a lot, but the state is intervening and putting their own stories, putting their own things, getting the people to write in a big way. And so that is what I feel much more dangerous, rather than just the trial of media aspect of it, where it's become, as many of us notice, terminology, Operation Green Hunt. Operation Green Hunt doesn't just go on in the jungles. It doesn't just go on home, paramilitary sending people to press Maoists or whatever. It goes on also in the mainstream papers, where people are fed news so they can counter a certain point of view which threatens the developmental model of the state. I think so. That's what I'm most scared about.
We brought up Binax and Arun, I wanted to ask your opinion actually about, in Binax's case, what's happened is that he was sentenced to life imprisonment and he spent four months in jail after he was sentenced, and then he was released on bail. So and now he's waiting essentially for his appeal and of course the Chhattisgarh government's appeal against his case to come up. And that's going to be effectively for many years. In effect, to me, what's the Chhattisgarh government has achieved what it wanted to is destroy this man's career without necessarily having him spend the rest of his life in jail. So, is this something that we should be concerned about? That the government doesn't seem particularly interested in actually appealing or getting this case moved in any sense. And that itself becomes a punishment. And do you have something to say on that score? Go ahead.
Of course, you see, in Chhattisgarh, there are no middle class as such. There are Adivasis and the planters. So Vinayak Singh's attempt was to create a kind of middle class. In fact, Bhargopal all the time was saying, he went 13 times to Chhattisgarh to take up what is happening in Chhattisgarh, particularly to Adivasis. He asked people like Vinayak Singh to do something there instead of people going from Andhra Pradesh. And earlier also, in fact, Vinayak Singh, as a doctor who is interested in the malaria-affected Adivasis, he took interest in them. He himself is a Gandhian, he was interested in them. So, sensing this, in fact, Vinayak Singh, another photojournalist, and then, of course, Ajit Sen Gupta, who was given 10 years imprisonment and put in jail, such two or three people who tried to speak about the democratic in Chhattisgarh, their fate has become like that. So after Binayak Sen, you don't find any person from there who can come out to speak about democratic rights. So as you said, In this way, they wanted to teach a lesson to the intellectuals. Sometimes it reversed, in fact, intellectuals have reacted otherwise. Sometimes some have taken. This is today you don't find anybody who are coming, except people like Sudha Bharadwaj and others. Nobody is left there to talk about. We have to send lawyers from outside. For every small case, we have to send lawyers from outside. And this happens particularly in the Adivasi areas, not only in Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, everywhere, I think. There lies the responsibility on people like us, people from Hyderabad or Bombay and other places. We have to look towards particularly the Adivasi communities or the Muslim communities. Because you can't get, when Gujarat happened, you don't have any democratic movement from, except one or two people. We people from outside have to talk about that, particularly about the societies who are being marginalized. Societies who are being treated as minority religions or minority classes. But such people you have to talk. And Vinayak Sen tried that, and states have taken it very seriously because of his nature also. States have taken it very seriously. And I think the lesson from Vinayak Sen's treatment for people like us is to withstand more seriously about and side of the Adivasis and the people who are being marginalized. Particularly in the context when Arun was talking about the media, he was talking about the state-controlled media. But today it seems media is controlling the state. Media in the sense the corporate media, because the whole interest is corporate interest. The whole interest is the imperialist interest. So it is the corporate section, it is the corporate sector which has made Modi the Prime Minister. The whole media, everybody knows that it is media who made Modi the Prime Minister. That is, you are manufacturing a consent for certain things, like a market. So this is very, you can't expect media to behave. Maybe the working journalists or the stringers at the rural level, they may be very sympathetic towards you. But at the higher level, where the decisions are not taken by the editors there, but the managers who happen to be also the corporate people, that all of them have companies. So as Arundhati Rai has said, that today there are no political parties, all are company parties. So they are dictating terms. So in this situation, I think, the media, which is supposed to be the fourth pillar of democracy, has turned to be a media with Western interests, the corporate interests. So it is controlling the state. In this situation, I think, the civil society has to play a greater role. And that will be a lesson from, you know, of course, there are many instances from, take the example of Anil Sat Gopal fighting in Hoshangabad, what the corporate people have done there for the Kishore Bharati and the scientists there in Hoshangabad. There are several examples. These attempts are there, but these attempts today have come in an organized way to fight back this system. I think the civil society has to respond more seriously. The democratic people have to respond more seriously than others.
Thanks, Mr. Bala.
I am S. Balakrishnan. Arun, my question is, on paper we are the most democratic country in the world, but in essence we are the most fascist state one can ever conceive. This major mismatch, don't you think, can be removed if we have an efficient justice delivery system, so that all the fundamental rights which are enshrined in the constitution, they become meaningful to the millions. The key to the whole problem of civil liberties movement and all that is to campaign for judicial reforms, to campaign for an expeditious justice delivery system, so that any case, civil, criminal, whatever it is, you get the judgment, it attains finality, any case, within maybe 6 months, 7 months or whatever it is. And almost all the parties, they are ignoring this issue of, a key issue of judicial reforms. What is your take on this?
Hello. In the book, I have consciously at sometimes avoided talking about the judiciary. for reasons probably you know best also. I think so. How the judiciary works, I can't talk about it because I've seen the present system where judges' decisions are not based on actually merits of case. Sometimes decisions are based on the points that a judge gets or a lawyer gets. Decisions are based on dates. Decisions are based on transfers. Decisions are based on whether that particular judicial officer is under inquiry and therefore he has to, appease someone. So I don't know. I don't have the answers right now. But I think so. It's much more deeper to just simple just changing the judiciary system. I think so. The society in which we live in feeds this judiciary system to an extent. I think so. I can't just understand how you can change the judiciary system without changing the society which feeds it. That's what I would like to
do. We'll take one more question. You spent 5 years in jail for no crime. Today, and now we see many other cases similar to you getting reported in the media. Akshar Dham Bhawan. So, is there some sort of redress that a person like you can get? What do you see as a future campaign for putting an end to such things happening? People being planted evidence on them, keep behind bars, and after 5 years being released, saying that they are innocent of the first person.
I think so. I'll pick up from where VB spoke about is that the question of democratic consciousness about, society needs to wake up to such issues when things happen. Because someone spoke about my experience in jail and how it has, Naresh asked me the question about going to the human rights course and how did it do. I think so. My experience in jail, if I would have to see, just taught me one thing is that read between the lines when you get someone like, Arun bail case picked up in Pune and he's a dreaded novice and his wife is picked up. So immediately I'll start reading behind the line, between the lines, what is the case, what is the facts. You get some stupid, I'll just talk about this much more because it talks about a democratic consciousness that we need to develop. For example, it talks about Arun Belke in Pune. I think so many of you all know about this case, a recent case about a person called Arun Belke and his wife Kanchan was picked up. Arun Belke was a co-accused of me in my Chandrapur case, so I know about him, used to come to court and all that. But the facts that the police is presenting in court is what? Is that he has some 30 people he knows in some bastis in Pune's and they want to investigate those facts. So what? Means as society we should start asking these questions is that, so what if he has 30 people? What is the need to investigate that? A political person can have those things. You have to investigate if he is involved in a crime, okay, you do an investigation like that. But such investigation doesn't make sense. So these things about reading between the lines and asking questions, I think so as a society we need to do that much more. What Vivi actually from the morning's session with Vivi and he spoke about torture and all that, I think so that is something that we really need to think about is how can we raise our voice to these things much more. And as a democratic, democratic movement, question these things much more because the Akshadham case talks about people spending many years in jail. It means why does a person have to spend so many years in jail and then realize that, he should be finally acquitted?
This room is filled with people who've dedicated their lives to building the democratic rights movement. And I suppose the lesson we learned from today is that we need to redouble our efforts. Thank you, everybody, for coming out this evening. Thanks, Ramo. Thank you, sir. Thanks, Arun. Run out and buy his book, which is available right there. Oh, and there are also snacks, I've been told. So please go get those.